Simon & Schuster Audio presents Ordinary Hazards, a novel by Anna Bruno, read by Amanda Dolan. 5 p.m. The final is the kind of bar that doesn't exist in cities, a peculiarity of a small town that has seen better days. It is so called because it's the last bar on the edge of town. The final stop after the final stop. The final. By last call, there's no place to go but home. The college kids head up the hill to the dorms, and the working folks find their way to the outskirts, where they can afford to own property or rent for cheap. The antique tin ceiling is the nicest thing in the bar, a sharp contrast to the vinyl floor, manufactured to look like wood, cracked and knotted. Vinyl isn't fooling anybody, not even a bunch of drunks at the end of the night. But we all like the ceiling. The tin tiles belong in an East Village watering hole or a tenderloin speakeasy. Polish and decay. I'm not sure how, but the black tin makes me want to stay so much longer and drink so much more. Indeed, black magic. I stare into my drink, and my peripheral vision catches movement around me, bodies adjusting on stools, sips of whiskey and long swigs of beer, wallets opening. Time is ours now. Time for a first drink and a second. Time to take the edge off. We've paid our daily dues, taxes have been levied, and we naively believe these hours belong to us and us alone. They are borrowed from no one, and they will remain in our possession until last call, and beyond last call, until we give them up to sleep, and to the morning, and then, once again, to the man. But only until 5 o'clock tomorrow, when we reclaim what is ours. On the edge of my stool, arms resting on the thick, old wood bar top, gouged and scuffed by the drunks who came before, I feel this split in my being. Like a schism. There are two of me, the woman I am and the woman I used to be. I wonder if these versions of myself can both exist, as if in two dimensions overlaid, or if they erase each other entirely, two extremes that average out to nothing more than middling. I close my eyes, and the smell takes over. Booze and dish soap. And I am her, the old me. And I can almost picture him walking through the door. A gold band adorns my left ring finger. I haven't taken it off. I'm playing with it, turning it around and around with my right thumb and index finger. I am more alone now than I was before because back then, before, I felt love, my body's experience of this state. Alive, my cheeks flush from the warmth of another. My lips red from a hard kiss, my muscles relaxed from endorphins, and after. I remember love, my mind's recollection of this state. Dead, a thing of past experience, beautiful but fleeting, a hummingbird that floats in place and then, in an instant, vanishes, never to return. The problem is not that I live in the past, the before. The problem is that I live in the present, the after. Lucas and I met 5 years ago, here at the final. I'd been living upstate for less than a year at the time, adrift. I walked into this neighborhood dive to meet Samantha, my oldest friend, only to find she had sent a man in her place. He had messy, longish brown hair and a trimmed beard, and I remember he was wearing shorts, because I thought it was an odd choice for a date, until I realized my presence was as much a surprise to him as his was to me. It was a blind date, meaning we were blind to the notion of it. We hadn't agreed to it. I received a text. It read, "Emma, meet Lucas. I'm sorry I can't join you, but I know you'll have a smashing time." We caught each other looking at our phones. Lucas knew I was Emma, and I knew he was Lucas. He looked up and smiled, and we were both immediately grateful. My first impression? I could have sworn he was Canadian. He was profoundly kind and unapologetically socialist. And by that I mean he didn't believe money was the barometer of success. Qualities that were alien to me, and at the same time, deeply attractive. In him, I'd found a Canadian at heart, who would never say A or make me watch hockey. He was the one. When Amelia delivered his third whiskey, Lucas raised his glass toward no one and said, "Lord, give me chastity, but not just yet." Surprise must have registered ever so slightly on my face. He looked down into his glass. "St. Augustine," I said, smiling, pleased with myself for catching the reference. He looked relieved. Lucas and I would eventually be able to read each other's minds, but not yet. This was our first date, and there was a bit of first date awkwardness. The good kind of awkwardness, the I like this person and I don't want to fuck up kind of awkwardness. Amelia filled my glass again, too. We were on pace. "Ah, I get it, Emma," he said. He stared deep into my face. Not my eyes, but my whole face. "For a second, I thought you were worried I drink too much." "But you drink too much, too." "Get what?" "That look you just gave me," he said.
"What look?"
"Promise me you'll never start playing poker," he said, "because I think I could fall for you. And it would be a real tragedy if you lost all our money playing poker." I punched him on the arm. His bicep was firm. He wasn't a big guy. His body was lean and taut, a runner's body. He had masculine, hairy legs, strong calves, and a great ass. I was attracted to him.
"Ouch.
You didn't answer my question," I said. "What look did I give you?"
"Surprise," he said. "You weren't expecting me to know St. Augustine."
I'd been in the final a couple of times before this blind date, but I'd never noticed the flock wallpaper behind the bar. Deep red, with a gold leaf trellis pattern. Vintage, and probably expensive when it was chosen. This backdrop suited Lucas, who seemed to me, even at this early meeting, to be from another world. The way he sipped his whiskey and talked about philosophers and pushed that flop of hair back on his head. It wasn't that he belonged in another generation, quite the contrary. It was that he belonged in my generation, but in a different dimension, where people weren't brainwashed by social media. In Lucas's dimension, minds were meant to wander, exploring various curiosities, and friends enjoyed long, uninterrupted conversations. "Is that what I was thinking? You can read all that in one micro expression? Maybe you should quit the drywall business and become a fortune teller," I said.
"More like a mentalist." "Sure. I think I could if I wanted."
He pointed subtly, through his body, to a couple sitting at a high-top table.
"First date. He's trying too hard. She's being polite."
"There will not be a second."
"Well, it doesn't take a genius, so you're telling me you weren't surprised?"
"Not even a little bit," I said. Then I thought about our friend Samantha, and specifically why she chose to bring us together in exactly this way. The blind date. If she'd done it differently, I would have asked her what he did for a living, and she'd have said something coy like, "He works with his hands." And I would have pressed her, and she would have told me, but she would have qualified it with color commentary. "He's brilliant." And she would have been right. But we would have already diminished him by the very need to qualify. And Lucas was a man who did not demand qualification. As he walked me home, our arms brushed against each other a few times, and I felt a rush of teenage giddiness. I told him it was my 30th birthday.
A blind date on your birthday, he said.
I thought I was meeting a friend, I protested.
Mission accomplished, he said.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.